Please join me in joining us at the podium, our superintendent for the San Antonio School District, Mr. Pedro Martinez.
Morning, everyone. First of all, thank you. I'm just so blessed to be here in front of you. So I want a couple of warnings. I'm on last slide, so I'm gonna go pretty fast because I'm pretty sensitive to your time. I will be emphasizing some points across the presentation. And really what my goal is, first, as always, I always wanna give you context of what's happening, not only in our district, what's happening in our city, in our nation, specifically around K-12 education, how we fit into that, how that's shaping the way we look at our work. I wanna show you the opportunities and what our children are able to do, and also what the challenges are. So, let's kick it off. So, of course, our mission and vision drive all of our work. We are in the initial stage of a transformation in our district. One of the things our trustees and I always talk about, this is a transformation. This isn't about marginal improvement. And we are setting our goal around the nation. This is about becoming a model for the school district. Our vision is very clear, and we're very explicit. We don't hide the fact that it is relentless. We are obsessed with making sure that our children are prepared for the best options possible. And frankly, we're very biased in favor of college. We really are. And we always get into this conversation about college. College, by the way, the big C. In other words, that means community colleges, universities, tier one colleges. And again, I'll show you a lot of data, how we're making it happen for our children. So let me first talk about our challenges. And again, I want you, when you see some of this information, again, this is about context. So this is a chart that shows you college attendance rates, and each of the lines shows you the different quartiles of income of families. So we always hear the news about the top 1%, the top 10% of wealth. Well, so the top line, is the top 25%, right? This is nationwide percent in terms of income, right? This is family income. And one of the things you see in this chart, it's all back to 1970, so 40, well over 48 years. And what it shows you is that, back in 1970, children coming from lower income families, about 46% were attending college. Again, this is college, all kinds of colleges, technical colleges, community colleges, universities. And you can see families in upper income were much higher, closer to 80%. The good news here is that gap started closing. Very consistent, by the way, with the fact that our nation is right now at the highest level in high school graduation rates ever in the history of this country. So very consistent. In fact, you can see, even though there's still a gap, it's narrow from that top quartile to the bottom quartile. But, here's the challenge. We have more children than ever attending college. This graph shows you children broken down by the same quartiles of income. And look what you see. In 1970, if you came from a family at the bottom 25% of income, your graduation rate, this is graduation rate on universities over 6 years, was 6%. If you were in the top quartile of income, it was 40%. Fast forward 48 years, and this is nationwide, ladies and gentlemen, our bottom quartile is now at 9%. Our second quartile is at 17%. Meanwhile, children coming from the top quartile is at 77%. The gap has never been wider. There's conversation about opportunity gaps. This is the context why nationally people start asking, what is going on with our education system? By the way, very consistent with the fact that our rankings nationwide in terms of K-12, as a developed country, we're now at the lower tier of developed countries nationwide in almost all core subjects, very consistent with this data. Because what's interesting, you'll see the disconnect. So there's a disconnect between what's happening in K-12 and what's happening in higher ed, right? And there's several reasons for that, and we'll talk about that. One of the questions I ask is, okay, I just saw this data, how does that affect our kids, right? So how many of our children are each of these different quartiles? And by the way, we see the income levels. So the bottom line is what we have seen is that 98% of our children are not in the bottom two quartiles, coming from families in the bottom two quartiles of income. So this is what it means, folks. A child is born in the West Side in 780207, which is my highest poverty zip code. As when they're born, their probability of graduating from a university is under 10%. Just from being born in that zip code, being born in that low compared to, again, a child that's born in a family is coming from a higher income. By the way, you see zero. We actually do have families that are in the top 4%, but it's so small, this is all rounded, that it isn't high enough to get above 1%. By the way, I hate to mention some families here that are attending my schools and say, hey, I'm actually in the top, I'll hire a little bit. Your family, except, again, it's just the numbers are so small, we don't get to 1%. So, again, context, right? So here we have this national challenge, and this is the demographics of my children. So what I'm going to show you today, though, is that it's not the children, though. Because I will tell you that when we do the right supports, when we give them the access to a high-quality education, I can easily show you results that will counter some of this data that we're seeing nationally. It doesn't mean that the work isn't difficult. It doesn't mean that we don't have to think of it. So you might say, well, okay, but what about Texas, right? Texas, I mean, you know, Texas is different, and you know, we're very proud of our state, and we've done in education. So this is what is the most recent information. This is the 2010 cohort, which this data means that this would have been kids that went into universities, this would have been them graduating in 2016, right? They're 6 years in university. And what we see in Texas is that 26% of all children in Texas graduating are getting either an associate's degree or a bachelor's degree, right? This is everything, associate or bachelor's. Again, I don't know about you, but again, it's concerning to me how low, so this is all of Texas, regardless of what income level it is, right? Those are the challenges. So again, context, you know, when you hear about, oh, you know, it's happening, the assessments have changed in the state, we're going from tax to star, and we're changing standards, and it's getting more rigorous, what is happening? And, you know, we're being obsessed by testing, and nationally, by the way, the same conversations are happening. This is why they're happening. Because people are asking, how can we have the highest graduation rate ever in our country in high schools, but yet we're seeing these type of outcomes? And one of the things that's fascinating, when you do this research of this data, this college data has been consistent for the last 30 to 40 years. The indicators have been always showing these huge gaps. But what we find is that the standards, right, this is what every state gets to decide. What should a child know in kindergarten? What should a child know in 12th grade? The standards have never been aligned to what higher ed requires. Just another data point, even though our K-12 education, we've fallen far behind compared to other developed countries, our higher ed is still the top in the world. Right? So there's this disconnect that people are trying to figure out. And then you get into the debate about, hey, should everybody go to college? Well, here, how many folks here would have the life you have if it wasn't for your education? Right? So that's the question that we always have to ask. And for me, is what option are we giving children? And so for us, I showed you the slide about what the makeup of our kids said, and I said, you know, there's been a lot of smarter people that have been in this job before me. And again, we've been struggling with performance for decades. We better really understand what's happening in our district. So we said, you know, first of all, when you look at the measure of poverty, in our world, we use the really the family child, qualifies for free and reduced lunch, and the average criteria, you see it here, is about $44,000 for a family size of four. If you make that or less with a family size of four, you qualify for free and reduced lunch. And so when we talk about poverty, everybody talks about, oh my God, my poverty numbers are increasing. You know, the majority of our county now is qualifying for free and reduced lunch. Texas is qualifying. I consider that a very antiquated measure. Because when you look at the national poverty line, it's actually $24,000. And I don't know about you, $20,000 is not a small difference. So we said, okay, let's even go deeper in our district. So we have over 50,000 students. We know their addresses. We use census data. And then we ask the questions. Okay, so does median income matter? We think it does. Does it matter if you come here coming from a single parent household? We think it does. By the way, half of my family is single parent households. Does it matter if the parents have either professors, I have some parents that are professors in universities, right? The children are in my schools, and I also have families that are homeless. Does it matter the level of education that those parents have? My parents have secondary education versus know, other parents may have master's degrees and PhDs. Does that matter? Maybe it does. Does it matter if you don't hear them home? Because if you ever hear Dr. Brennan's presentation, she always reminds me of Spago. It's not just when you make them, it's about wealth. And guess what? The number one driver of wealth is your home. So does it matter if you are a renter and you don't own your own home? We think it does. So we took all this information and we did it, and we used census blocks, we took every address, and we figured it out, and we broke these, we grouped all of our families. And so we call them lots because the census has 300, in our district we have 320 census blocks. And what we found, and we said, block one, which is more of my middle-class families, they own their own home, they tend to be two-parent households, they have a higher level of education, median income for those families was $50,000. Good to know. By block four, which I call the poorest of the poor, single-parent households, they don't own their own home, median income is under $20,000. In some of my communities, the majority of adults only didn't have a high school diploma. I have very large numbers of illiterate adults in some neighborhoods. That's my block four parents, folks. By the way, I have over 7,000 children that live in public housing rentals. Their median income is under $12,000. I have over 2,000 children that are homeless. I mean, we see these children every single day. We know. So this is not just data for us. We know who they are. And so now we have it, and we can see school by school, what is the diversity of our students so that we can align our resources, right? So let's learn from this. This is not, by the way, an excuse by any means. Because by the way, I'll show you schools that are, regardless of these demographics, they are actually outperforming many of their peers, not only in our district, but in other districts, that don't have similar challenges. So again, this does not dictate the future of these children. We need to understand it, because if I don't understand it, how do I ensure that I only have limited resources, so where do I put clinical social workers? Where I only have limited resources to have communities and schools and city here in my schools, where do I put them if I don't have this type of data? Right? So that's what we did. What was fascinating when we did this, we assigned children to go into our district, and we had their addresses. So we said, where do we map them on? Right? Because we know where they live. And you see the little box on the left, the second one, what we found is the majority of our under district families were block one families. Well, that is really interesting. So what is that telling us? So then we said, let's use this system for the entire county. So we overlaid this block system countywide, and look at the colors. So the red is block four families, which is the poorest of the poor. Green is our block one families, right? Look what happened when we overlaid this on the county. What we learned is that between San Antonio ISD, Harlandale, South San, and Edgewood, by the way, some of my colleagues saw this from those districts, hallelujah, they were finally somebody talking about this. We have 82% of the block four families in this county. Look at the amount of green that surrounds us everywhere. So when I share with you that free resources is an antiquated way of looking at poverty, this is what shows you how antiquated. And I'm not saying that our other districts don't have challenges, but the work is different. And so, you know, when you compare us, I'm very competitive, by the way. You'll see in some of my slides how competitive I am. But you need to understand the context of this work. Because if we're comparing how schools are doing, our children are doing, we need to put it in the right context. Not to make excuses, but to have the conversations, whether it's at the city level, at the county level, and an employer. How do we shape the future of this city? How do we help these communities? Because I will tell you, sadly, the way economic development has happened in this city has driven much of this. And right now, you can live in certain parts of our city, like Stonewall or Lafayette, and never have to ever visit any of my neighborhoods. In fact, I would wonder how many have ever visited one of my neighborhoods. Because you don't have to. So then you don't have to see it. Right? You don't have to see it. And if you don't have to see it, you don't have to do anything. One of the things I'll tell you about our state that's very challenging is we're one of the most underfunded states when it comes to education. And they don't want to see it. Although the commissioner is asking now to present this information. Because he's done this similar analysis, now he's using it not to look at the entire state. And so it's back. So again, the conversations are happening. So, okay, Pedro, what does that really mean? I mean, I really don't understand what that means. Science, like, yeah, you have a tough job, basically, right? Is that what you're telling us? Okay, you have a tough job. This is what it means, folks. So, you know, recently our amazing community approved a bond for us to invest $450 million in our buildings. We said we will have to raise taxes about 12 pennies. We'll do that gradually, about 2 to 3 pennies every year. Northside just approved to go to the voters, we'll be going soon to the voters, asking for $849 million, and they said they're going to have to raise their taxes just under 5 pennies. When you do the math, what it means is that for one, our taxpayers in Northside, 1 penny that they pay is the equivalent of 4.5 pennies than one of my taxpayers pays. And you explain that it'd be, you know, Northside's much bigger than you, so that's not a fair comparison. Folks, they're not 4.5 times bigger than us. If they were, they'd be the city. Not city of Houston. So is it right that that same penny of tax that my parents are making under $20,000, right? Whether they're renters or owners, and they're paying that tax one way or the other, that it's worth less. And how does that pay up when my children from San Antonio, as they go to a regional event, a decathlon or a sporting event, and they walk into these amazing high schools that have cost over $150 million to build, right? They're palaces. Kudos to them, by the way. This is not, I love the fact that they did that. But then, I look at my buildings, which is, you know, our newest high school, Solomon's High School, we were able to invest $60 million there. And it wasn't because we didn't want to invest $100 million, we just don't, we can't generate it. By the way, if I compare it to Northeast, the gap is even bigger. And it's growing every single year. So, does this have ramifications? Absolutely. And it's very visible. So again, but if you don't have to see it, you won't know. And again, this is about context, folks. And what's sad is that in our state, there is a very clear correlation with high poverty schools and low performing schools. It is very, very correlated. And again, this is not to say this is an excuse for us to perform worse. But I will tell you, and I'll say this right now, and my trustees know this, and we talk about this all the time. Sadly, in our district, we know that historically we have not done the best for our children. And we own that, by the way. And when they hired me, we had a tough conversation and said, are you ready to own this and to make the necessary changes? Because the challenges are there, right? And of course, and I'm finding, by the way, the challenges are much deeper than I realize. That's okay. I'm up for a challenge. But are we ready? Those are the conversations we season we have on a regular basis, by the way. Sometimes our closed session discussions are even longer than our closed discussions. Because this is what we're talking about. So, those are the dots of low performing schools, what they call considered improvement required campuses, 371. 91% of those campuses have at least 60% of their children qualified for free and reduced lunch. Very strong correlation. And like I said, free and reduced lunch is an antiquated way of even looking at poverty. But even with that, that's what the numbers are. Statewide, 371 campuses. By the way, and I got the permission of the commissioner to say this because I never say anything without getting his permission on this kind of stuff. With the new standards and changes in the accountability system, easily this number will at least double or triple statewide. Easily. And the only reason it won't be higher is because it's worried about the politics of our governor's running for election. I shouldn't say that. But you know, that's just happening. Very strong correlation on this, right? So these are the challenges. Again, context. Just context. So how are we doing our work? We talked about our academic goals in the past, we talked about our pillars. What I will tell you is that we're starting to see our pillars really intersect. Because as we're creating high-quality options, we're finding some amazing partners, right, there that have a track record in doing this work, because we can't just repeat the same practices of the past. And we're creating some very innovative choices. And by the way, we are aggressive, I think, about talent. There's certain districts that I can't drive into anymore because, you know, they're really anonymous and you cannot talk to my staff, Pedro, because it's like, you know, we have all that every day, but we are being very aggressive. And we're grounded by making sure we're changing our culture because we got to do our part. We got to be focused on students. We have to have high expectations. That is the culture shift we're making. And we have to be accountable to our taxpayers. Because again, I'm never going to lose sight of the fact that my families earn very little. And by the way, over 70% of them approved two tax increases. That was almost a double-digit tax increase. And they, you know, that's something that I have to respect. So he's heard about some of our amazing innovative schools. And these are, in many ways, first of their kind for Bexar County. 22 lounges, you just saw and heard the children. The first all 100% dual language school in Bexar County. All children, by the time they finish a grade, will be bilingual. And what I love is also it's about culture. It's about appreciating the history of San Antonio. But each of these different programs, and I'll show you some data on what, are generating such a buzz and such a demand from parents. We are also redefining career tech. Hashtag, we haven't been to the place, go visit. It's like the high school that has never been done before, especially here in Texas. All focused on helping children, connecting them with the tech sector. Because there's amazing jobs. And I just need children to see that they can be in one of those jobs. It doesn't matter if they're coming from a poor sector. CIA, Communist of America. Some of the most famous chefs here in San Antonio are graduates from CIA. And what I love is they're not at the mirror. We have certified our teachers, we're using their curriculum. My kids that are passionate about this work, probably going to own their own restaurants one day, right? The next time you're in this, they are getting a year's worth of college transfer credit into the CIA. It's working so well that I can do this year before next year. So these are the partnerships that we're getting. Okay, it looks different. By the way, CIA, high payments. I love them though. And at the same time, we're asking our existing schools, you gotta get stronger. YWLA, Delia is our amazing president that's here in the world. Not only in the top in our country, folks, national awards come out. Travis Early College, where almost 80% of our graduates get associate's degrees. Listen to this, parents. In 4 years of high school, they also get an associate's degree, right? They're already halfway there to a bachelor's, coming out of high school, now a national university. We will have the largest graduation at the Royal Baccalaureate County. And for any of you who've ever traveled abroad, the International Baccalaureate program is considered the most rigorous in the world. And we've had a small program at Bourbon, which is expanding significantly. Jefferson will be a lead. The feeders will be leading, and we will have the largest international baccalaureate program in the county. And we also have amazing turnaround stories happening in our schools. This is a percentage, so the word is getting out. So as we're expanding these choices, this is the percentage of out-of-district families that are applying to these choices. Ladies and gentlemen, in some of our schools, if I could, and I wouldn't put it in the so don't worry about this, but I could fill all the seats with out-of-district families. That's how high the demand is. And one of my favorite compliments I get is, my goodness, Pedro, for the first time that I can remember in the last 10 plus years, San Antonio ISD is on the map. People are talking about these options. And then what I love is they're willing to give us a chance. By the way, we are stickers for quality. We are stickers on who we're partnering with. And there is a deep partnership with each one of them, whether it's Trinity University at ALA or our partnership with Rita at Ogden. These are deep partnerships. Here's a map. So the blue is the district boundaries. Each of those dots are applications. We had 7,000 applications for 3,000 choice seats that we get. And look at where they're coming from, all over the county. And this, as I said, many strategic partners. We are also elevating our highest performing teachers. We're creating residency labs. We will have the largest residency program, definitely in Bexar County, one of the largest in Texas. This is, think of the medical industry, where we're taking residents, individuals that are in our schools all year, just like residents in the medical profession, under expert master teachers, and creating our own pipeline for talent. We have, like I said, I've been aggressive around expanding talent. I want to just acknowledge my cabinet members. These are just the newest additions. By the way, every one of these individuals, renowned in the state, in many cases even renowned nationally. I just want to ask my team to stand up that's here. Please stand up and just be acknowledged because you're amazing. Here's what I'm really excited about. Let me show you some data points we're seeing with our kids. Right? Because again, the biggest thing I want you to have, regardless of all these challenges, and this is what gets me motivated. It's not our kids, folks. It's not our kids. and we do the right things, and we work with the community, we work with the parents, it is amazing what our children show us. So first of all, we're seeing the highest graduation rate ever in San Antonio. We're now at 85%. Dropout rates now are at 10%. Our goal is to be at 90% by 2020. We see that it's very realistic. We have more children going to college. This is, the work is still early. So right now we're up from 50% to 54%. This is a very conservative number because we are very careful about sharing this type of data. We will get more final data in the next few months, and we know we'll get a couple of percentage points that will be higher. What I love, though, is look at the mix of colleges. We're going from 40% going to four-year colleges to 48%. And we have more than double the number of students that are attending today. Top tier universities, not only in Vegas, but all over the country. So with that, thank you.
Increase in the number of students that are
Madrid, Tokyo, Boise, and so many more students are taking the assessment, and the percentage is rising. One of the early indicators, so another way to know whether your child's going to be successful in college is remediation. And in Texas, they use what they call the TSI, the TSI assessment. So if you have a family and you're going to school in Texas, you need to know this. Because if your child does not pass this exam, they have to take remedial classes. One of the biggest indicators of whether your child will graduate from a college, whether it's going to be a college or university. So look at the bars. We're the dark blue. In the last 2 years alone, we are now exceeding the state of the percentage of children passing, these are graduates, passing the TSI in English. We're now exceeding the state passing the exam in math. But that means for our children are going to college, they're not taking remedial classes anymore. And I just showed you, we have more children graduating, more children going to college, and what this is showing you is they're coming in better prepared, they're not taking as many remedial classes. That is a direction we're going. And in 2 years, with a focus on this, we're already exceeding the state average. So again, this is who we're going to be, folks. This is what we're about. One of the, biggest indicators around college readiness is AP and IB, right? Those have been around since we were kids, right? Back in the 1970s. And you can see we have now over 1,850 students taking AP and IB classes. By the way, that's before our expansion of IB that I just showed you earlier. So these numbers are going to go up significantly. They're going to be much higher over time. But already with that, we're seeing more children passing those AP exams going from 60% to 23%. We also are seeing, going back in the early grades, we have more of our children now that are not only taking algebra 50% English by 8th grade, more of our children taking 9th grade English in 8th grade, almost 46%, look at the performance. We've more than doubled the number of students and have not seen any reductions in performance. One of the things that we know for poor poverty families, we have children that are gifted, but yet parents don't know to have them diagnosed and to be tested for that. So means they know that, right? Some of them take thousands of dollars. We have universal screeners now, first and fifth grade, for every student identifying these advanced students. And because of that, for the first time in our history, our state is matching the state in advanced children in elementary school. So again, think about this, right? We have more, we're recognizing advanced children in elementary school. We're exposing more of our children to 8th grade algebra, 9th grade English, and 8th grade. We're exposing them to more AP and IB. We're getting them ready for the SAT. We're getting them past the TSI while we're graduating them, and we're getting them into college. That is who we are, folks. So I want to make it clear that is who we are. So, in closing, the work is about changing these data points. Because it is not fair to tell a child that based on where you're born, for no other reason, just being born into that community, into that family, that income situation, that this is your probability of graduating college. When they're born, folks, this is not a 12th grader, this is at work. By the way, overlay teenage pregnancy, overlay reduced lifespans, overlay all the things that you would be fearful for your family. That's what my high poverty families are seeing every single day. And that's what this is showing. Just for them being born into that situation. That is not right. So we will own this. This is who we are. This is what the work is about. Everybody who's joining my team, they know this is the work. And that is the direction we're going. And we've seen these quotes before, right? And what we have to ask ourselves, and we have our city manager here, right? Everybody's got to applaud her courage because she's making some tough decisions, getting some technical. Because she's seen that chart, right? She knows, even if she hasn't seen those people, she knows what that chart looks like in terms of the green, right? The block one, block four, right? Because all of us can see it when we drive over there in those neighborhoods. And so, the question for us, we have amazing things that are happening in our city. So as we look at what's happening, the growth, the potential, can we learn from the past? Because folks, we will own education. We will own us accountable to ensure that our children have a high access to a high quality education. But I can't own them. I'll just share this quick story. We have thousands of children that have learning disabilities. Thousands. And I ask my staff, tell me what's driving that. I want to understand that. Because I have children myself, and I'm always worried about those situations. And they say, the large percentage of them, the These families live in dilapidated housing and they're exposed to lead on a daily basis. That's what's causing the learning disabilities. I said, look, we'll own education. I can't own the lead, folks. I can't own the dilapidated housing. That's where I need your help. So what I ask you to be two simple things, not simple, but two big things. Stay with us. This work is long-term work. It's going to take time. By the way, with standards getting more rigorous, things will get worse in our state before they get better, but it's for good reasons, because we're raising expectations. We're trying to create better alignment in K-12 with higher ed. I'm showing you the direction we're going. I'm showing you what our children are capable of if we align our supports together, if we work with you. But I need your support as we look at how the city evolves and grows to learn from the past so that we don't continue what we have right now, which is such a segregated city. And it's just created so many challenges, and I have to remind my teachers and my principals and all my staff, remember what you're here for. Remember what the work is. I know it's overwhelming. I know you're struggling with this child, but this is the work. And folks, all I ask is, give our children a shot. Thank you.
Clearly, you are the right man at the right time, and your board is 100% behind you, and that's why good things are happening. You've got a staff that's completely and utterly committed to your vision, and so that's why we need to move that. But you're right, it's long-term. And actually, anything that we do in the city is long-term, because we've had to choose in our city for a long time. So it's all of us, and that commitment, that community commitment, is going to make things happen. So with that, we'll ask if there's a couple of questions that anybody might have. So we're running a little late. So if you could state your question quickly, that would be good. Anybody with a question? All right, well, there we go, right over here, yes, sir.
How badly does this affect the chamber, and how closely do you guys work together with regard to all the various chambers and the school district?
So, first of all, the chambers are amazing partners. Everything from supporting in our last two tax elections, conversation when we get more children on job traveling, different employers, and the chambers, what I love is that they know that we have to work together on this, because it's not just about education, it's about economic development, it's about the type of companies that will come to San Antonio. It's about the access that these children need to have to create employment opportunities.
So when you ask any business person, what is issue 1, 2, and 3 to workforce development? It's having that primary material that makes businesses work, and that is the people, having them ready to take the jobs that exist today. And then the concern is the ones that are coming for tomorrow. And so we work very closely with Baylor, with all the superintendents, in fact, with the city, to make a concerted effort. Number one, in funding, that has been the biggest challenge at the state level. And then to work together so that as kids come out, that the expectation of what they're bringing to the table works for what is actually needed at the workplace. So it's a great partnership. Any other questions? Yes, please.
How do you identify the call to action for individuals from SAISD that have gone on to do other things? What are the first steps to get involved and help you in your mission?
So, you know, like I said, you know, Leon and I am blessed to have such an amazing board who has the courage to have these conversations and address these issues head on. And so for us, you know, internally, we're making it very clear about this is the direction we're going. It is going to create pushback, right? Because our district has had a history of different special interests who've gotten their way, and it was not always in the best interest of our children. What I love is that my board is willing to take that on. By the way, that hasn't necessarily been the history of our district. What I love right now, you know, and Richard said this, I think we're blessed that we're here at the right time when the community, frankly, our state, was ready for us to have these changes. And so we're going to continue to need your support. And I will tell you, especially, and I'll say this for my trustees, who have grown up their lives here in San Antonio, they need help and support, because when they make these tough decisions, they have to face some of the individuals they've known for 20 years who just will not agree with the decision we make. And they don't have, because we don't have the access to the details that we have. And so where I need help from the community is support my trustees, support my teachers, because they're facing these children every single day. And I'm just trying to make sure that we don't burn them out. I'm trying to make sure that we don't overwhelm them.
Well, thank you all for joining us today. We'll stop the questions there, but Pedro will be here, his team will be here, and of course we'll be here to chat with you about any ideas and opportunities that you have. Before you go, Pedro, we've got a couple of gifts that we'd like to give you. Got several books that we'd like to donate so that you can put them in your schools and hopefully inspire young people. This first one is called Sarah the Cyber Hero. As you all know, we have a burgeoning cyber industry in San Antonio, so we'd like to see if you can put that in one of your libraries. And then we also have another book, which is a Caldecott winner. It's called So You Want to Be President. Hopefully this will inspire young people to do what you're doing and lead the way and lift up our city. Thank you. Thank you all very much.